Now that the artwork for my pedal is completed, I'm ready to print. First, let's prepare the paper. This Waterslide Decal paper comes in 8.5 by 11 sheets, which I'm going to divide into three pieces. The smallest size my inkjet printer can use is a 4x6. So I'm going to cut this on my rotary trimmer into a 5x8.5, which I could later use as a 5x7 by trimming off the edge, and two 4x6s. The 4x6 will be perfect for most effects pedals, they'll trim to fit, and the 5x7 will be good for larger effects pedals, or if you can plan well enough in advance, you can print multiple pedals on one sheet. Once these are all cut, you just have a little bit of waste, and it's a pretty efficient use of the paper. Now we're ready to print. I'm going to select my Canon Pro 9000 and set some preferences. I want to select glossy photo paper and set it to the highest print quality. And then since we're going to use a 4x6 and my printer can do it, I'm going to select a 4x6 paper size. Also on my printer, it's helpful I've found to turn off this detect paper width thing. And that's it for the preferences. Let's go ahead and print it. Make sure you don't accidentally print on the back of the paper. This Canon Pro 9000 prints on the side facing you. To conserve your decal paper, it's a good idea to do a test print on regular lightweight copy paper, and you can save ink by just printing a subset of the art, like the labels. Aside from confirming which side of the paper your printer prints on, you can use this test print to check whether you've positioned the labels and artwork in the proper place relative to the holes in the enclosure. Now, because this paper is pretty thin, if you hold it over the enclosure with a light behind it, you can see pretty clearly whether everything's in the right place. Then you can go back and do any final edits you need in your image editing program before doing your final print on the Waterslide decal. Now, after printing on an inkjet printer, the ink is usually pretty dry, but it's best to wait a little while, maybe 30 minutes or so, and then I need to clear coat it to protect the ink so when it gets wet, the ink doesn't run. I'm using this Krylon crystal clear acrylic in a satin finish. This stuff sprays on really thin and dries really fast, so it doesn't take long to put on a few coats. I shake the can every once in a while just to keep everything flowing. Then I'll spray a few passes in one direction, and then I'll walk around and spray a few the other way just to make sure I'm getting a good, even distribution. Now you notice that when I spray, I start a few inches off the side of the paper and then spray until it goes past the other side of the paper so you don't get any big wet spots. Now, a good way to check if you're getting even coverage is to look at the paper with a low-angle light across it. I'm just using the sun. That makes it really easy to see if you've missed anything. Here's a good example of a decal that obviously did not have a perfect clear coat. After soaking the decal in water, the ink started to dissolve in the upper right-hand corner here, so I had to throw this one away and start over. So this was a 4x6, and I'm just cutting it down on my rotary trimmer here, which makes it easy to cut nice straight lines, down to the final size of the pedal. I'm trying to cut pretty close to the black borders of the pedal art, but not so close as to compromise the integrity of that line. Now, once I'm finished cutting, I'm just going to hold it over the enclosure and make sure that it looks like it's a good fit. If I need to, I can go back and cut off a little more. And this looks all right, so I'm just going to use a pair of scissors now and round over these sharp corners to match the rounded black borders. Now, this isn't strictly necessary since the decal will mostly be invisible once the pedal is finished, but I find that the sharp corner, if you leave it there, tends to draw your eye to it. Rounding them over just helps to soften them a bit so that it blends a little bit better. Now, I have a dish of warm water here, not hot, and I just drop the decal into it. You can see that it curls up right away, and I just flip it over and hold it under the water until it stays underwater by itself. After a couple minutes in the water, come back and check if the decal's ready. You just pick it up and sort of pinch the decal with your thumb while holding the backing paper, and if the decal starts to slide off, then you're ready to go. But if it doesn't move easily, then just put it back in the water for another minute and try again. When the decal is ready to apply, clean off the surface of the enclosure one last time and leave a little water on the surface to help things flow. Then roughly position the decal in the right place and gently slide the backing out from underneath the decal. Now you see why it's called a water slide decal. Well, it's pretty hard to get the decal in exactly the right place in one step, but you can see that water slide decals are pretty forgiving. While they're still wet, it's very easy to move the decal around, but you should avoid trying to move it around too much. If you've got any bubbles between the decal and the enclosure, Use wet fingers to iron out the bubbles. You can see I'm holding down the decal with one side while I push away from it with the other fingers. You gotta try to be very gentle so that you don't stretch the decal and so that you don't accidentally shift the position again, although that's very easy to do because it moves so easily when it's wet. So after some final adjustments, it's best to just leave it alone and let it dry. After everything is dried, I come back with a sharp razor and cut out the holes where the potentiometers and switches will go. You can see that I'm angling the blade towards the center of the hole and just dragging the razor right around the edge. Now this doesn't have to be perfect because it's all going to get covered up by the washer and the pots and switches, but it's a good idea not to leave any really rough edges or bits and pieces hanging off because you don't want to get a snag and tear the decal. The smaller holes are a little bit easier than the big ones, but it's the same process. I just keep the blade angled towards the center and do sort of a sawing motion around the edges. Now if you have any loose bits that don't want to come off easily, really resist the temptation to go in and grab it with your fingers and tear it off. I've made that mistake before. You can end up tearing the decal or lifting it away from the surface. You see, this one's being a little stubborn. It's best to use the razor and just slice it off. Now if you see anything that needs a little touch-up, now's the time to do it because the next step will be to clear coat this and it won't be so easy to fix anything later. That looks pretty good. For the top coat, you can use the same crystal clear acrylic spray, but since it goes on so thin, you need to do a lot of coats in order to get a nice, thick, protective surface. Another option is to brush on some polyurethane or water-based polyacrylic, and that's what I'll be using now. So I'm just gonna stir this up, not shake it, and because the finish cures in oxygen, I'm gonna transfer a small amount into a disposable bowl and keep it covered with plastic, and that way I don't have to keep the can open for very long. Now I'll be using a high-density foam brush, and then I'm just going to brush on a relatively thick coat. This stuff goes on looking kind of milky, but it dries nice and clear. Also, you may see some little bubbles in the finish while it's sitting there, but it self-levels really well, and you don't have to worry about it too much. So I'm going to do the entire surface. You can see I'm brushing one way and then the other just to make sure I get good coverage. And then I use a little flashlight to shine a light across it. Looking at a low angle, you can really see whether you've got good coverage. See, I missed a spot in the corner there. Then I'm going to go around and do the sides, make sure I hit the corners. And because the sides are a vertical surface and gravity is not in our favor here, if you put on too much finish on the sides, it tends to pool along the bottom edge. So try to brush on a little lighter here on the sides, but if after it dries you find you have a little extra thickness along those bottom edges, we'll be doing sanding between coats, and you can use a sanding sponge to rough down those high spots if you need to. Now you can see that I'm using vertical strokes at first here, but then I'm going to come back, and while holding a flashlight pointed straight down at the surface, I'm going to overbrush horizontally just to smooth it all out. And again, the flashlight really helps to see if everything's even. Between coats, I'm just going to store the foam brush in a Ziploc bag and zip it closed, try to get all the air out of it, and that'll stop the finish from curing on the brush. Of course, you can just wash the brush with water between coats, but this saves a step. I'm also going to cover up the bowl with plastic to stop it from curing. Now, dust is really the enemy when you're finishing, so a little trick I like to do is to cover up the project with a clean bowl. I'll prop one side up on a wood block so oxygen is still able to flow through and allow the finish to cure. Even if you think your room is pretty clean, you'd be amazed how much dust is floating around. So this really helps. Now I'm going to set a timer so we can keep track of how long it's been drying. The instructions on this polyacrylic say it'll take between 2 and 4 hours, depending on the temperature. Okay, let's take a look. It'll be pretty obvious if it's not dry yet. Just look across it under a low angle light, and if it still looks like it has wet patches, come back again later. This looks fine, so between coats, what I'm going to use is between 320 and 400 grit sandpaper to give it a light scuffing. This is a 400. You can also use a very fine or extra fine sanding sponge. I like to keep these both handy. The sponge is a little more aggressive. And the intention isn't to cut all the way through the finish we just put on, it's just to give it a little bit of tooth for the next coat of finish to adhere to. Now for the purpose of this video, I'm just doing this right here in front of the camera, but it's actually not very smart to make a bunch of dust right in the workspace where I don't want any dust. So definitely do your sanding in another room and then wipe it down with a cloth before you come back. All right, second coat, same as the first. If you've seen one, you've seen them all. The number of coats is up to you, really. The more you do, obviously, the more protection the pedal will have. I'm figuring that this thing is going to be under my feet a lot, so more is better. I'm planning on doing about 4 coats, which means this project is going to be sitting out on the table here overnight. But most of the time really is spent waiting. It only takes a couple minutes for each coat to do the sanding, wipe it down, put on the coat of finish, then cover it up with the bowl, and come back again a few hours later. And like I said, the process for all the coats is basically the same. The only difference is on the last coat, you don't need to follow it up with any sanding. After the final coat is dry, an optional final step is to buff on some paste wax. This is something I do when building furniture to give it an extra level of protection and shine. I just use a clean paper towel, load it up with a little bit of the wax, and then just wipe it onto the surface. You can make little circular motions, and it doesn't have to go on thick. Just keep going until you have a good even coverage, and then we're going to let it sit for about 10 or 15 minutes. Don't let it sit for too long because this wax dries really hard and that makes it harder to buff. I'm going to come back with a clean paper towel. I'm just going to buff it out. This takes a little elbow grease, just using a fair amount of pressure, circular motions, and going over the whole surface. And it's pretty easy to see when you look across it in the light whether it's smoothed out or if it still needs a little more buffing. For the ultimate smooth and shiny surface, you could even use an electric buffer, polisher, or a pad attached to a cordless drill, that kind of thing. But I'm not going to bother. I mean, this thing's going to get footprints on it anyway. This is more for protection than for beauty. All right, final home stretch now. It's time to install the electronics. I'm going to start with the LED bezel. And something to keep in mind is that with all these coats of finish, you're going to notice that the holes are a little bit smaller than they were before, and as you push the components through, some of the finish around the holes is going to flake off, but it's nothing to worry about. I have a set of these long socket wrenches, which are handy for tightening things down in tight spaces, easier than a crescent wrench. And the different sizes are good for tightening down the other components too. Next up will be the LED and the switches and the jacks, and then finally you get to plug in your guitar and rock out. So this concludes my video series on finishing your own guitar effects pedals. This one's come a long way since my first design sketch on a post-it note. I'm still considering doing another series on the electronics inside the pedal, maybe a simple boost or fuzz. But I'll leave that for another day. For now, I hope this has been helpful, and thanks a lot for watching.